Ladies, gentlemen, people of the internet, and all of my no-nonsense weirdos, welcome to the show. Once again, I pluck the fruit of early access, and while I hope for a meal, I get but a taste. This week, I am talking about Bright Memory, an action arcadey first-person shooter with some melee thrown in there for good measure. It's fast and intense, it has some cool power-ups, and some fights that will test the strength of your trigger finger. Also, it's a half hour long. That's not an exaggeration. I have 2 hours into the game and I've beaten it 3 times. It's really more of the free demo that would come along with a Kickstarter campaign. A Kickstarter campaign that I would back, by the way, because it's very fun. It's a really neat game. And it's only $7 US, and so if we run it through our like fun per hour calculator, it's still a pretty good deal. Bright Memory is one of those rare early access games that is polished. It looks slick and has a firm grasp on the tone and core gameplay loop. It was developed by FYQD Studios, which is one single person. Yes, one person made this game. That's fairly impressive. FYQD focused on quality over quantity, and so you really get solid action gameplay and only a few bugs.
It looks like they've found the beam too. I have to hurry and catch up.
In Bright Memory, you play as SRO agent Shelia, who gets teleported to the hidden islands of the North Pole. It's a place full of magical creatures and futuristic soldiers, all of which want to kill you. So, what is SRO? What are we looking for on these islands? What's our main objective in the game? Who are we fighting against and why? We don't have time for that shit. Get out your guns and shoot at the mythical beasts. Oh, I'm sorry. You didn't know there were mythical beasts in this game? Well, they are. Now go shoot them with guns. Bright Memory is an action-heavy first-person shooter. It's far too busy kicking ass to worry about world building or introducing characters or making sense. It's pretty standard as far as first-person shooters go. Some light platforming takes you to an area where enemies spawn, and then you shoot the enemies until they die. Some baddies will drop bullets, kind of like the push-forward combat of Doom 2016, but those drops only refill the guns you currently have out, so you do have to pay attention to how much weapon swapping you're doing. You get a machine gun, a shotgun, and a third gun that you'll never use. Overall, the guns are fine. They have a light feeling, so you know, not much kickback or force. And really, that's okay because the fights are so fast and hectic, in a good way. Honestly, you're just so busy running around the battlefield and reloading that you might not even notice your guns are on the screen. Really, my biggest gripe is that the guns are so bland and indistinguishable. Besides your magazine size, it's hard to tell the difference in their look or even power, so I usually went with the machine gun just because it was faster to reload. So you know what, actually that is a pretty big problem, because if your first-person shooter has a weak shotgun, like what's even the point of having a shotgun? You get a sword that you can occasionally use, which is neat. You know, you jump into the fray, slash up some enemies, and then wait for the cooldown. And along with that, you get a couple sword powers, like a slash shot and a ground slam to send bad guys into the air, which can lead to some really fun combos. You know, you throw an enemy into the air and shoot at them while they're up there and defenseless. It's neat. Then you have your superpowers. You get an EMP blast, which will also throw enemies up into the air, a freeze time power, which actually that might have been another bug. I thought I had that equipped, but it did the same thing as the throw people up in the air thing, so I don't know if that was a bug or I didn't equip it correctly, and I don't know. I don't know if I used that right. And what I will call the slashy dome. It's a net that forms around you and slices at any enemy within the net, and it also stuns them, so it's the only superpower you're going to need. All of your powers and the use of your sword are on cooldown timers. So in the battle, you're always swapping from gun to sword to power, and it makes most fights fast and intense and on the edge of your seat spectacle. Except for boss fights. If you've ever wondered what the term bullet sponge meant, just keep watching this clip. The boss's health bar barely registers after a full magazine dump. And with the big, bland arenas that you fight them in, you're gonna find yourself running away while reloading, turning, firing every bullet you have, only to run away while reloading again. That cycle gets old really fast. You know, just give me something else to do in these battles. Like maybe like a parry mechanic. That would be cool. Heck, even give me some glowing weak spots to shoot at. Just something different. And the boss fights highlight another thing that I think needs a little tweaking, which is your dodge. You have the ability to dodge left, right, or backwards, but you don't move very far away with the dodge, and I always found myself getting hit whenever I was trying to, you know, avoid an attack. This could be me. I might just need to learn the tells a little bit better. But it also felt gummy and inelegant. So I'm just gonna blame the game. It is definitely not me getting older and slower. It's the game's fault. The game. Not my fault. Another issue with combat for me was judging the hit distance for both enemies' melee attacks and my own sword. I always felt like the enemy was too far away to hit me, and that the game was cheating. You know, it's not me. I know how long that sword is. It's definitely the game. It's the game's fault. It's not me. I don't need to get any better. It's the game. The game's cheating. The game is cheating. And you get a grapple hook. That's pretty fun. You mostly use it to traverse the world, but you can also use it to grapple yourself right into the enemy's face and zip around the battle, making things even more hectic and wonderful. Fast battles, great time. Shooting the guys, shoot the bad guys. Pew pew, shoot them up. So, as you're watching this gameplay footage, you probably have many questions about the world and its enemies. You know, you're probably saying, wow, futuristic army guys, zombie skeletons, giant lions with fish gills. How do they fit all of that into 30 minutes of gameplay? To which I will say, ha! They fit that in the first 5 minutes of the game. Heads up, everyone. This is Editor Jack. I am about to run down the entirety of the game, all of the enemy types, including the final boss. So if you would prefer to experience that yourself, please click to the time indicated below or else you will be spoiled. It's gonna happen. Like right now. Spoilers are coming. And now. You start Bright Memory by breaking into a high-tech facility and fighting future army guys. Awesome. You then somehow get teleported to the floating island hidden at the North Pole, where there are lion-like creatures, wolves, zombie skeletons, a giant-sized knight, axe-wielding demon werewolves, a dragon, and flame-spitting bats. Yeah, yeah. Then you somehow get used to all that weirdness and inconsistency, and this is the final boss. I don't even know how to describe this besides showing you this footage. You know, I know it's a game that's pretty early in development and it's only being made by one guy, but what the heck? It's actually so bizarre that I can't be mad at it. It's so eclectic and mishmash that I love it. I think it's great. Being someone who plays so many games, some of them can feel a little routine. And for me, it was just so refreshing to be surprised, even if it made no sense whatsoever. Bright Memory is a short, weird little game that is filled with off-the-rails action. And you know, whether you're laughing at it or with it, I guarantee it'll put a smile on your face. Like, I didn't need to play through it three times. I just wanted to play through it again because it's big, dumb fun. Ha! As a side note, here's a quick tip to all developers out there. When you start a character on a level, don't face them towards something they can't get to. After the short tutorial in the tech lab, the game drops you in the North Pole, and I think FYQD wanted to show off his neat world, and so he starts you facing outward, like looking at this cool floating island. The only problem is, it kinda looks like you can jump to that little rock that you're facing, and so I tried to jump to that rock, and you can't. You just die. It's not the biggest deal in the world, it just kind of started my game on a sour note, having to turn around to find the stairs and dying right away.